So that we have to relativize the subjects all the way through. have is meddling with the idea that proofs constitute the objective basis for deductive sciences like arithmetics. So in mainstream logic, one avoids the discussion of this embarrassing situation by simply ignoring the notion of proof. Instead, one concentrates on formal proofs, determined by deductive system and its inference proofs. And they are, of course, entirely objective. But it does not help us much to understand the notion of proof. At best, applications of given inference rules can't be seen immediately valid. And so this gives us examples of proofs. So, or more precisely, we could say that deductive systems they codify examples of the proofs. But this is not much help if you want to clarify the concept of proof. So, if we think of a proof as a chain of inferences, the crucial problem is whether there is something we could call legitimate inferences. So inferences that can be used legitimately in a proof. So is there such an objective property of proofs? And this is a problem that is usually not raised in contemporary logic. However, there was a concept for this kind of inferences already at the birth of logic. So after having defined the notion of syllogism in the open and closed passages, the syllogism is a discourse in which certain things being stated, something other than what is stated, follows a necessity from that being so. After having defined syllogism this way, Aristotle distinguished between what he called perfect and imperfect syllogisms. In his words, as I said, by Ross, a perfect syllogism is one which needs nothing other than the premises to make the conclusion evident. So, in our happy argued by John Corcoran in particular, the distinction between perfect and imperfect syllogisms is essential for Aristotle's whole logic program. So in the end, it is the perfect syllogisms that the proofs must be based on. The perfect ones cannot be used before it has been demonstrated that their conclusions follow necessity from premises. Aristotle made no attempt to analyze what it is to make syllogisms perfect, but he was clear about some relations between the notion of perfect syllogism and some other basic notions. So, according to Aristotle, it stands to imperfect syllogisms that the demonstration or proof gives us knowledge. Reasoning that used imperfect syllogisms would not give us knowledge, although it knows even for imperfect syllogisms that the conclusion follows a necessity from the premises. So when Aristotle defines the concept of syllogism, saying syllogism is a discourse in which certain things are stated upon, he seems to think of syllogism as a kind of speech act. And when you see an inference in that way, the importance of the concept of perfect syllogism becomes also very clear. In more modern terminology, one just speaks about justification. So when we state an inference in the course of a method of theory, we form a speech of a somewhat complex kind. We assert a conclusion, but not only that, indicate what we take to be ground for that assumption, and additional presupposed premises. We take, for instance, something like A, B, therefore C. So now three assumptions here, A, B, and C. And also the claim that one has a ground for C. So generally, we expect of assumptions that they are not made out of the blue. The speaker should have some grounds for what she asserts. Or the assumption should be justified or warranted. And the point of the inference is to provide such justification, to give us knowledge. Of course, it may be that the premises of the inference are not assertions, but are only assumptions or hypotheses. The conclusion is that an assertion made under these assumptions, and it may actually be rejected as a categorical assumption, in which case we subsequently reject one of the assumptions. But this does not essentially change the picture. In any case, an inference evolves among the things, assertions of a conclusion, possibly other assumptions. And assertions made under assumptions could also have some kind of ground. So this is the case. So in view of this, you can say that an inference is logistic, even though they are making the inference, except that you have justification of the premises, thereby gets justification of the conclusion. Note that I'm here speaking of justification of the conclusion, not justification of the inference. An inference is legitimate if it has this power to provide a justification of its conclusion. And the crucial question that we put like this, what is it that gives an inference this power and makes it legitimate in a sense? So this is the main question I want to discuss here. And my first ambition is to make clear that it is a difficult question. It's not easy to answer. So the problem is to find this kind of property then. Now, of course, there could be a kind of sociological answer to the problem in terms of what is gender recognized as well. The good one is kind of sociological, of course. So the question is, can we give some kind of philosophical account of this notion of identity? Now, I could think that it is not, it's wrong to ask, to ask whether there is a property of inference that is crucial here. It means that instead a relation between an inference and the subject makes the inference that is relevant. So then one could formulate the problem as follows. So find a property P of inference and the relation R between such inferences, such that the subject stands in this relation R between and who has justifications for the premises of the inference gets thereby a justification of its conclusion. So this, one could ask whether there is such a property P and the relation R. And one may think that the obvious solution to this problem is not complicated, it simply is. The subject should know that the inference is valid. Consider that P is validity and S stands in R for the inference if she knows the inference to be valid. However, the idea that an inference has to be known to be valid in order to be used in the proof leads to difficulties. if the knowledge is based on arguments, so knowledge of the subject is based on arguments, then for it to have any force, the inference occurring there must in turn be known to be valid, which leads to an obvious request. It's not a scandalous request, it's not a request, but anyway, it's a request. So either knowledge must be implicit in some sense, or not related, it must be somehow be self-evident.
Basic laws of thought,
And this specification proceeds by recursion of the root of sentences. So our entire model inferred this case of in effect of this condition, which we can illustrate here by giving these recursive clauses for conjunction and implication. So a proof of conjunction consists of proof of the conjunction. And the proof of implication consists of construction C, which transforms the proof of the first sentence A into the proof of B. It's a well known process. So here we see now to the objective notion. There's no mentioning of a subject, but nor are inferences mentioned. And one may ask whether proof in this sense proves anything. The mere existence of the construction C that transforms the proof of A into the proof of B is of course not sufficient to be justified in the circular implication, but the existence of this. And this is something that has worried intuitionists. When Proust was presented what he called the VHK interpretation of the Lorentz operation, P standing for the hour, H for meeting, and K for Chrysler, not for the world, he made an addition to P for implication, which then read, the proof of A in fact consists of construction C, which transforms in the proof of A into the proof of B, together to the inside that C has this property. So, Proust seems to be a little hesitating about this addition since he put it in parentheses. But he was inspired here by Chrysler. And in Chrysler's own work, the clause for implication is quite straight, saying the proof of implication consists of such a construction. Together with a proof, B, of the fact that the construction C has this property. And D here, the proof D, is a proof in the usual sense. Objections against clause B has also been raised by Michael Duncan, because it would make the notion of proof of desired exercise. He replaces it by this. Proof of negation is a construction C which we can recognize that, of which we can recognize that, applying an appropriate So when these additions or limitations go essentially back where we started, I think there is a case of calcium, unanalyzed proof, or as the case of Proust or Thunder, with concepts that arise on subjective notions as an insight or recognition. On the other hand, I must say that Hinkins clause B, as it stands no longer, it remains objection that one cannot be justified in a certain implication because of the mere existence of such a construction. So I shall soon return to the justicious notion of proof. But besides the problem just discussed, we may note that the definition proceeds by recursion over the build-up of sentences. So, this proof of A and B is to say, we say it as a proof of A and proof of B, which is not what one expects. Proofs are usually understood as generated inductively by successively adding inferences, while the recursion over the build-up of sentences is quite natural when one wants to explain the meaning of the logical operations and all sentences formed by them. So the question is how one would then approach the problem of saying what it is that what it is that makes an inference to build. Well, those who have considered this question at all have just referred to the meaning of the sentences involved. And I think it's quite controversial that whether an inference is legitimate must depend, at least partly, on the meaning of involved logical constants. But the controversial question is where the meaning comes from. And one must distinguish here between two different questions. What is the meaning of this or that notion, expression in the story of the given language? And what meaning do I want, or we want, to confer on a certain expression in the language that just rely on the meaning of boundary constants in Dutch language, even such a simple thing as the commutativity of conjunction doesn't hold for and in the English. So the validity or the dissonance of the inference usually depends on the meaning that we confer on the boundary constants. We should agree, they agree only partially to some of the language. And this is, of course, recognized in our usual accounts of the linguistic method. The standard procedure has been to specify the meaning of boundary constants by stating truth conditions for various forms of sentences, relying upon primitive conditions. this is an ocean, that I descend in the X bar, so here I have a lot of discussion as an ocean. But before entering that, that in the third is not in the problem that has isolated. So I have taken for granted that having proved a sentence A, one is justified to so be. This gives me a reason to reject certain things as truths because of not being reasonable to say that they provide a reason. But what reason do we have for accepting something as a truth? Can we again use the criteria that they should justify the assumption? So we must ask, what kind of justification of the assumption? And if we answer that the truth of A is what counts as a deductive justification of the assumption, then it's not. So having given the proof of sentence, we must certainly be justified in asserting A. But this should follow conceptually from what we mean by a proof and by being justified. Explain proofs and justifications in terms of the charter. So a way of dissolving this knot is to inquire into the notion of justification independently of its connection with proofs. So this is what we have to develop now. So to develop an independent notion of justification, not independent by the existence of proofs. Let me use the name ground for this. Say, for a certain date under the assumption A. Having this notion, we can say something is a ground for a certain implication, it can only can be formed in this way by an operation applying to a non-saturated ground, for example, the other assumption A. And at this time, in this case, we bind the variable, as we say, we form from the non-saturated ground, we get saturated ground. Now, this is a, now you can see clearly that what I'm suggesting here is, in one way, I'm just using the introduction inferences in Gans's system of natural function, and in another way I'm also using just I'm using the Huygens or Lindrich-Nisley explanation of sentences in terms of what they call groups, which I call now grounds. Now, we can go on like this to form the grounds for assertions of universal generalizations as well. But let me just say that there is nothing, what I'm using here now, the intuitionistic notion of proof, there is nothing particularly intuitionistic about this idea. So even from a classical point of view, we may take the ground for conjunction to be formed in this way, and also it would be different if you take an existence state as a disjunction, then one would have different grounds for classical and for intuitionistic reasons. Now we may know that formally the meanings of our sentences in ground state are not referring to accepted inference patterns. But in effect, of course, I've said that Gans's introduction inferences are legitimate just in terms of the meaning of the conclusions, since they specify what constitutes a ground for sentence that produced the proposition, which gives a ground for the conclusion of such an inference when applied to ground for the premises. We have these operations. So each operation used to specify the ground for sentence is such that it gives a ground for the conclusion when applied to ground for the premises. So there are such critical operations, but only for the introduction. For other inferences, we can apply new operations to the same property. For instance, for a conjunction, for conjunction relation, we can define operation like this, conjunction elimination, there are two according to the technique, and that is just pulling out the ground for the contract conjunction. And so then it's clear that if we have a ground for the conjunction here, then by applying the conjunction elimination operation, we get a ground for the conjunction. See what I mean? For those components. Having a ground for A times B is by definition to have something like this. And having now a ground for the minor premise A, now we're şundan şundan getirmesi, which is objective. Instead of recording to what the subject sees, or find is better than, so the reason is of the interest in the mind class about the computation of that operation needs construction of the right time. So by carrying out an inference, the subject is justified in the certain hypothesis, thereby gets in possession of the ground for the conclusion, and hence becomes justified in the certain conclusion, regardless of what the subject thinks about it. One may discuss whether this notion of justification is externalistic or internalistic. It's externalistic in the respect that, as defined, the subject is justified in making an assertion when, in fact, she is in possession of the ground for it, although she may not be aware of this fact. And one may discuss such a notion for this reason. On the other hand, the subject is of course aware of the possession of the construction that she has obtained. By applying operation to the house for the premises. So she is aware of having this construction, and if one is demanded that in addition, she should know that this construction is in fact the house of the notion, must start to address this kind of analysis.
Two minutes.
So, the subject can of course easily become aware of the fact that the construction of this possession of is in fact the ground for the conclusion. To know the meaning of a sentence, as I have pointed out, is to know what counts as the ground for a certain. And hence, in the case of introduction inference, the subject knows the meaning of the conclusion and is aware of the possession of grounds for the premises, becomes aware of the possession of the grounds for the conclusion by just activating this knowledge that lies in the construction that she has carried out. If the inference is not of an introduction type, the subject needs to reflect upon the meaning of the involved sentences and the definition of operations that she has applied to the grounds for the premises. And to convince herself that the result of carrying out the operation is in fact the ground for the conclusion, she may need to perform some inference of the mechanism, one of which will typically be of the same kind as the one she has performed about it. But to require that she should have done that before she can be considered to be justified in the subject of conclusion, this obviously just not to address the paradox. But we can now define the proof as a chain of legitimate inferences without the mentioning of the subject. So, inferences are understood in this way, in modern direction. So thinking of them, of a chain of inferences of this kind, which are legitimate, that is that the ground is a ground for conclusion when applied to ground for the premises, that will of course yield the ground for the conclusion of the proof. The proof of the sentence as now understood does not constitute a justification of the search for the sentence. It is the possession of the ground for the search. There was so, as I have talked. But the proof delivers a ground, so the proof is a ground, it delivers a ground for such a proof, and has the justification of its structure. The proof of the sentence is thus seen as the means for finding a ground for such a proof. The subject gets the possession of a ground, and thereby becomes justified in a certain sense by proving it. That is, by carrying out the shape of that inference. And this is, of course, something, this individual proof is, of course, something that has been brought about by the subject. But that it is a proof depends on features of the inferences that the subject has made, and these features are objective in the questions about many features of this proposal that should be discussed, and also the explanation of all the proposals. But
so, thank you very much to Professor Prawitz for this very nice and interesting paper. Professor Prawitz has been to call him back, and I will very respectfully do so. Right, so I think that that paper has two main aims. So, the first is to show that the question what is a proof is a hard question, and I think we may agree on that. And the second is to suggest the possible answer to this question, one or another that requires us to account for the meaning of sentence in all the qualification terms. And my comments, well, first I will inherit some parts of that argument and make some relevant comments. And then I'm going to try to resist Bach's claim that his account of what proof is requires us to be verifications about meaning. And the last part of the comments, I will mention a couple of more or less standard objections to verifications that comes of meaning. Right. So, suppose an inference, a proof is a chain of inferences that we seem to be valid, and then the question arises as to which inferences can legitimately figure the proof. And that offers the following definition: an inference is legitimate or entirely, even only if by naming it the subject was a justification for the premises, whereby that's a justification for the conclusion. And the hard question, of course, is, in virtue of what relation should the subject stand to an inference in order for that inference to be entitled? Now, a bad answer to this question is to say, well, that the subject must know that the inference is valid. We get into a rigorous practice, rigorous practice, and in order to draw this rigorous, that writes that either the knowledge must be implicit in that sense, or the validity must somehow be such evident, presumably because of the meaning of the sentences involved. And my first quick comment would be that, well, one might reject this discussion and attempt to draw the rigorous along only externalist lines. So it seems open to argue that the subject S can get a justification for the conclusion of an inference I if S as a justification for its premises, S is made I, and S is inferentially reliable, but roughly the subject is inferentially reliable if she is disposed to deduce a conclusion from some premises only when the conclusion really does follow from them, and to recognize at least some of the more obvious cases of wrong statements following the model, and that's a quote from Murzi. And of course, this will need a lot of fleshing out, but I think that this possible statement is worth considering. Max's favorite answer to the question what is a legitimate inference is one according to which an inference is legitimate or entitled if it's constitutive of our understanding of some of the expressions that figure in it. And following the question, let us call this meaning entitlement. And I think that one of the main claims of that paper is that whether this meaning entitlement depends on what we mean by meaning. So let's assume, following standard semantic and logical practice, that meanings are two conditions and validity is defined as a true representation. Let us call this semantic hypotheses. And then the relevant instance of the meaning in fact would be that validity an inference highly subject with a justification for the premises, gets a justification for the conclusion, roughly the subject knows the true condition of the logical expression that the figure in mind. So I'm going to focus on logical inferences. So that's what that does and that's what I'm going to do. So that concedes that on these assumptions, a rule like conjunction and production may be enhancing or legitimate, provided that, well, we know the meaning of conjunction, so we know that conjunction is true, if and only both of these conjoints are true, and we know that an inference is valid just in case of true. Well, of course, things get trickier as soon as we move to more complex logical operators, so that's conclusions that semantic orthodoxy and the meaning entanglement view can be coherently maintained. That lines that in general the validity of inferences needed in deductive proofs is not self-evident, at least not when validity is explicated in terms of logical consequences in a usual way. Hence, within the framework of modern logic, there isn't this easy way out by appealing to knowledge of the validity of an inference. And my second comment, I'll be trying to resist this conclusion. So it seems to me that this argument assumes that, well, semantic orthodoxy is in place. To know the meaning of logical expressions, to know the truth conditions, and truth conditions validate rules and on the other way around. But it seems to me that even conceding the first two assumptions, one could still maintain that to know the meaning of logical expressions is to know somehow this introduction of the meaning of expressions. And then one could hold that these rules determine the meaning of the expressions, that is, they determine the conditions on the assumption that they preserve truth. And then one might say that the meaning constitutive rules for logical expressions are entirely. Well, first we grasp these rules. We have a justification. We master these rules. We have a justification for the premises of these rules, and if we apply these rules, we thereby get a justification for that conclusion. And it seems to me that foregoing both the influential framework is compatible with both the meaning entanglement view and the framework of modern logic. Roughly the idea that to grasp the rules for logical operators, to grasp its sense, and that the reference of the logical operator to this function, practice, and sense determines reference. And we might need to distinguish between the sense and the reference of the logical constant, because there's logical questions that you know the same function, and yet you might want to say that they have a different meaning. That's an example, but we don't need to go into that. Right. So let me move now to Doug's proposal. And so there is an idea that the meaning of a sentence is explained by what can constitute a ground for it, and that to be in possession of a ground for a sentence is somehow to be justified in certain ways that sentence. And grounds are operations that transform the ground for the premises of inference into grounds for its conclusions. And as that points out, these operations by the way of the sentence and the upshot of the scene is a somewhat richer notion of an inference rule. So I have a quote that writes that if accept what I call grounds for assertion, we should take an inference as being determined or integrated by premise and conclusion, but also by an operation applicable to the given round of the premises. So, on this assumption, that answer to the question of what is a legitimate or compatible inference is along this line, implies that since understanding the inference is way as involving also on occasional grounds, we can distinguish a legitimate inference as wrong by the operation, thus in fact clear the ground for the conclusion quantified to the grounds for the premises. Now we get exactly what we're looking for the fact that reasons the subject to perform a legitimate inference and as ground for its premises, thereby that's the perception of ground for the conclusion. Now I have some questions before I move to some potential objections. The first is whether we think that this framework can generalize to presumably non-logical and yet seemingly generalizing inference, such as, for instance, from X is prior to X is product. And then the second question, or the second minor point, is on class dismissal of the franchise approach to the meaning of the logical operators. So that provides an alternative way of fixing the meaning of the logical constants is to exhibit certain inference patterns, saying that the acceptance determines the meaning of the constants and thus he mentions projections, one is the problem of consistency, and another problem is incompleteness. But the first thing I want to say is that well, you see that my proposal is still a form of inferences, one which different schools are interpreted in the somewhat future way we have just seen. And if this is correct, I think it might be helpful to clarify why we think that this proposal based on grounds is immune for the objections that are meant to apply to inferences of logic. And then I will try to a specific point. So the objection from completeness is that it is difficult to see how to reconcile the idea that the meanings of certain expressions are exhausted by a number of accepted meaning inferences with the fact that by reflecting on inferences that we accept, we are led to accept reflection principles that are not derivable from these inferences. So for instance, if we accept the axioms of Lyano arithmetic, then we are implicitly committed to accepting the reflection principle of the arithmetic, and by the reflection principles we can derive among other things the Dirac sentences for the arithmetic, which were not derivable from the axioms of the arithmetic alone. But, I mean, I agree that reflection principles may spell trouble for the differential account of mathematical expressions, but I wonder why this should also be cause of concern for an inferentialist account of the logical vocabulary. Right. So, now, the verification implications of that proposal. So, we suggest that this account of what the legitimate inference depends on the controversial idea that the meaning of a sentence is somehow based what is required to justify insertion of sentence and causes from that point. And he wants in the paper that to know the meaning of a sentence that set it out is to know what counts as a ground for assertion. Well, I think that one can make essentially the same point I made earlier and say that, well, that's a count of a legitimate inference meaning requires that the grounds for certainty in the context take sentence to be a necessary condition for understanding the sentence. And if this is true, then it would seem that this account of what a legitimate inference is consistent with saying that the meaning of the logical operators are given by the two conditions. But in order to know these meanings, one also needs to know which operation on grounds these logical operators are associated with. So the idea is that roughly that there is more to knowledge of meaning than knowledge of truth alone. So if this is a real option, one you need to give the verification in order to adopt kind of account of inference. Now, that might object that this is to divorce truth from acceptability conditions, and if you do so, we preclude the possibility of manifesting knowledge of meaning in our linguistic use. Perhaps this may be, but there seem to be reasons for thinking that this possibility may also be in general included to the kind of verificationism done in Zagreb. So consider the sentence, the speech sentence. And according to that, the sentence can be made true by the existence of knowledge have, whose members are expected to be at one for A and at one for nobody in the element A. But how to manifest knowledge of the meaning of the sentence? Well, antiquities might come at and Tennant would say that, well, we can manifest understanding of a sentence by being willing to recognize the proof of that sentence incorrectly. If the sentence is true, the sentence is called useful. But in this case, if the sentence is true, then we can't recognize the ground for the sentence on the basis of the prediction. And then my last comment is that there seems to be a difficulty in explaining meaning in terms of grounds, and these are well known difficulty and values very well. So in order to avoid the holistic view of meaning, the verification needs to specify what counts as a canonical ground for a sentence. On the assumption that either the non-canonical grounds for the sentence can be reduced somehow to canonical grounds, or a grounds for what counts as a non-canonical ground doesn't constitute our understanding of the sentence irrespective of whether non-canonical grounds can be reduced to canonical grounds. And as well, I think that is states of preference for the first option, and in this option, which is essentially a balance from mental assumption, is problematic if applied to the complex statements and probably also to complex statements. Because, for instance, what, if anything, can count as a canonical ground for saying the sentence that China oppresses Tibet? And the question is an important one, and I have a quote from a recent paper that says, well, it's the whole verification project that is in danger by the fundamental assumption and